Welcome to the Del Walmsley Radio Show. Del challenges the status quo, questions everything, and empowers you to return to your core beliefs to make your life better. If you're ready to hear the truth and get your roadmap to the lifestyle you really want, the next hour will change your life. And now, your host, self-made millionaire, national award-winning investor of the year, CEO and founder of Lifestyles Unlimited, Del Walmsley.
Welcome to Del Walmsley Radio Show, where the hype ends and the help begins. I'm your host, Del Walmsley, and as always, we're working on your financial freedom. Well, my friends, I just got back from vacation. This is the first vacation I've taken since COVID started out of the country. I mean, I've gone to little places here and there, but real vacation. We went to Cabo San Lucas. The event is an annual event, but has become semi-annual because of COVID. But 2 years ago, my wife and I got married in Cabo San Lucas. And when we were there, we took probably 100 guests with us, had a great wedding. One of our friends, Brian and Meredith Sifford, which Brian also is a Lifestyles member, Brian and Meredith are, and they're apartment owners. And Brian also teaches classes for us too. They got married. We found out they got married exactly 10 years ago on the exact same day. We got married on 4th of July. They got married on 4th of July. And they got married in Cabo. So when we got married 2 years ago on the 4th of July in Cabo, they came along with us and they re-upped their vows. So it's a beautiful thing. And when we go, we take a group of people with us. You know, just it's like a group party. Let's go to Brian, Meredith, Melissa, and Del's wedding anniversary together. So it was a great thing. But as always, when you get away, you come back with different perspective about life. And it was a great visit. I came away with some incredible perspectives about life that I would like to go over with you. So I think that it's something that first we'll start out with this. I don't know how valuable you see a vacation, but to me, vacations are probably one of the most important parts of recovery from life. When I went this time, man, it's been a long time and I needed this. And I know people that go on vacations all the time. Frank and Madeline, friend of ours, they go on vacations. They're gone 3 weeks out of the month, gone somewhere, doing something. And you say, well, how do you do that? I say, well, number one, you have to be retired, not have a job to go to. And number two, you got to have a lot of money. And so therein lies the old adage, well, you know, money can't make you happy. No, money can't make you happy, can't buy you happiness, but it can buy you relaxation, fun, location, excitement, food. It can buy you all the things that if you have a normal, balanced life that will make you happy. But if you have a lot of time and you have no money, you can't do very much. So time's important, don't get me wrong. But having some money is important. Now, if you got a lot of money and you're working like a dog and you've got no time to take away, then that's a problem. Now, I looked it up because I just wanted to have some factual information to throw into all of my conjecture. But what I found was, according to research, 40% of Americans take one vacation a year. Okay, 40%. The other 60% don't take any vacations. Can you imagine that? 60% of Americans don't even take a vacation. We're in Europe. I think there's some city or some places in Europe where they close the entire country down for like a month or two for everybody to take vacation. It's just strange how workaholic we are here in this country. It goes on and says that those vacations are, on average, not longer than 4 days. So in an entire year, you get 4 days of relaxation, and or that's only 40%. 60% take no vacation at all. Now, within the 40%, there's a 28th percentile of everybody who gets three vacations or more a year. Again, the average length of vacation for Americans is about 4 days or less. So even at three, that's only 12 days off during the entire year out of 360 days. So that seems to me to be a little unbalanced until I thought back about when I worked and I had a job in corporate America. And it just blew my mind because I never took off. I just thought back to it. They would only let us have 2 weeks of vacation a year. They made you feel bad if you took the vacation. I remember going away on vacation when I was running six health clubs. And if I'd go away and any one of my six health clubs would do poorly, they'd go, Delcy, you can't train staff. You're useless. The place only works when you're here. That means you're a terrible staffer. Or I'd go away and we did great. And I'd come back and go, look, you know, we don't really need you. These people are so good. It's not you. You're not making it happen. These people are good. So it was a no-win situation. That's kind of the way your company looks at your vacation, right? So The point is, there's not enough vacation time for people out there. Now, I'm going to take it one step further. I'm going to go a little further here with this. And I'm going to talk about all the different things that vacation mean to you and how deep the perspective is about why you should take vacations. Let's go to number one, relaxation. Improve your physical health. This whole thing here talks about stress and how stress contributes to disease and high blood pressure and this and that and the whole bit. But I'll tell you what, I look at it like this, is that when you go there, it's what I call island time. It takes you 2 or 3 days to slow down to island time, to where you don't care. You're not getting up and looking at your clock and trying to time your day and get as much stuff as you can in during the day. You have to take a long enough vacation. You get to where everything you had to get done is done. You're relaxed. You just take your time. And that's when your heart rate goes down and your blood pressure goes down. It's just a completely different thing. I'm retired at home. I don't really have a job I have to be to. I do radio shows. They're 1 hour long, so it's not like I work all day long or anything, but I really have the rest of my day to do whatever I want to do. But yet, even then, I can't get to the level of relaxation. I mean, in fact, I'm going to try to do it, to get to that level of relaxation you get when you're laying at a hotel, at a resort somewhere, and you get up, and there's no time limit. You walk down to the restaurant, and they feed you breakfast, and you're in your swimming suit. You know, I don't think we put our clothes on but one or two times the whole time we're gone. And when I say clothes, I mean like street clothes. And you eat that breakfast, and then you relax and let it digest and lay by the pool. Then you get up and go in and work out, get a good workout in. Then you come back out after a good workout and run out in the pool again and cool off, so it's splash and sun. And then you eat by the pool. Just so they bring you food. Just eat by the pool and relax. And for some of you, it would drive you crazy because I'm the type of person, I can't sit. I can't just lay on a chair and lay there all day long. But I can get up and get into the pool and talk to people and spend time doing what I like to do, which is meeting people. And then I have a lot of fun. Then I have just tons and tons of fun. And then, of course, you go out to different restaurants and everything. But what's important about it is you're doing it with your friends. This is a difference about the whole thing because it's just this camaraderie-ship of being out there with other people and meeting other people. And I don't care if it's people you meet there and befriend and then go do stuff with, which is fun, or if it's people that come with you and you go do stuff with them. But it's just different. And being on vacation is different. Now, I saw that some of the guys we had with us own businesses. They own apartment complexes. And my wife operates our apartment complexes. So what happens is that they take calls, and they usually try to get it done. They get up in the morning, and they get it out of the way real quick while they're eating breakfast, and then they're done with it, or before they eat breakfast, and they're done with it, and got it out of the way. The rest of us who don't have anything to do, we just kept going morning, noon, and night. But it's still different. Even if you just do a few emails and a few calls, it's still different being away. The next one they talk about is improved mental health. And for me, this is really the most important. What am I talking about? When I get away and I sit and see other people, meet other people, see other things that other people have, see places that people live, see different things in my life, it starts me to thinking, where am I? Am I where I want to be? Do I have everything I want to have? Is there something else I would like to have? Or would I just like to change? Maybe I'd like to change. Maybe I have enough, but I want to change. And you start questioning things about where do you want to live? I mean, every time I go on vacation, I question where do I want to live? You go someplace, it's beautiful, it's incredible. You go, man, maybe we should live here. And then you get into that mindset and you start thinking about that. And then you go, well, if I want to do this or I want to do that, should I have more businesses or should I not? Do I need more businesses or should I not? Do I have enough money or do I not? All these types of things start to come out of just sitting there, doing nothing. That quiet time needed to get there. We'll be right back with the Del Walmsley Radio Show.
Welcome back. Now here's some more unconventional wisdom to set you free from the man on a mission to retire America, one person at a time, Del Walmsley.
Welcome back to Del Walmsley Radio Show. Today we're talking about a vacation I just came back from and how important vacations are for people. I was reading into this article here about what vacations do for you. One of the benefits for vacation is the fact that it relaxes you and it changes your level. And they had some name for it, some kind of test they give you. It says health and well-being index. And it said that people that take vacations have a much higher health and well-being index. But what's interesting, it says that it elevates it for about 8 weeks. which I thought was interesting. It said, boosted happiness. Research shows planning a vacation can boost your happiness. Some people experience an elevated mood for up to 8 weeks before the trip. And the bottom line is, take vacation. You can take time away from the stress, work, and life, and it can improve your physical and mental health, motivation, relationships, performance, and perspective. It can help you feel refreshed and more prepared. So you get excited 8 weeks before the trip. It gives you something to look forward to and to be excited about. And then once you've taken the trip, it relaxes you for another 8 weeks. Then the question is, how often should you vacation to stay at peak performance? And I used to have a friend that took one vacation a month. He was a Lifestyles member, retired, and his goal was to take one vacation a month. The way he did it was, he bought timeshares, and he'd go spend 1 week in each timeshare all year long. And so he's always away 1 week out of the month. And you know, whatever, which way you figure out how to do it, that's one thing. But the bottom line, to be able to keep regenerating yourself is just a wonderful thing. Now, I don't know if there's such a thing as it gets old, and we talked a lot about this while we're on vacation, why buying a second home somewhere doesn't work. By the way, the people I were with, everybody there had a net worth of between $10 million and $100 million. So just give you an idea, we're not talking about, you know, kids, and we're not talking about middle-aged people that barely can pay their house note and stuff. We're talking about people, we're at the most expensive resort where we're at type thing. And typically because of that, there's only old people there. And when I say old, older than 50, you know, mostly pretty wealthy people. And we were talking about, well, why don't you just buy a condo in this place? Or why don't you just buy a house up there on that cliff? And we looked at them and we priced them out. And I'm going to get in that in another segment. But it really is cheaper to live in Mexico than it is here by far. And incredible quality of life. But again, I'll come back to that. What I thought was interesting, though, is that everybody I talked to, everybody I spoke to, said it makes more sense to not own a second home or a condo or a lake house or a beach house or anything if you realize that you have to go back to the same place every time. And so you can't really travel. You've already spent your travel dollars on something fixed in one place. Secondly, you have to go there and clean the place. You have to go there and cook your own food. You have to take care of your own linens. You have to take care of everything. Whereas the way I travel is this. Have a guy carry my bag to the taxi, from the taxi to the airport. The airport people take my bag. When I get off, a guy picks us up and takes our bags to the taxi. The taxi takes our bags to where we're going. That guy carries them to the door. And then a butler, or whatever you call him, whatever the bellhop guy is, he picks them up and takes them to your room. And then when you leave all your trash and your garbage and your used glasses and drinks and plates. You just walk away. You don't clean your linens. And you reverse the process. Somebody comes up and gets your bags. You get in the car, take you to the airport. Somebody carries your stuff again. Boom, you're out. That's the way to travel. But if you've got to carry all the stuff, and if you have to maintain that house, think about it. All year long, when you're supposed to be productive, making money, so you can live life at the quality you want, if you have to think about taking care of a second home, if you have to think about the taxes, the toilets, you have to think about the plumbing, the electrical, the landscaping, you have to think about all that stuff. And then you start to think, man, a second home really is not the right thing to do. Not to mention that you've got money, dollars tied up in two different homes. Whereas opposed to you could have money in businesses and then a home. Now, I will argue this point. What I'm seriously looking at expatriating, which means move someplace like Mexico and just stay there and no longer live here in the States, because I don't want to maintain a home in the States. It's just because I don't want to maintain it. I don't want my money tied up in something I'm not watching that I'm not right there for. So, well, Dell, they say, well, you can live in the States and have this nice home in Mexico, and they can rent it out when you're not there. So you really want other people in your home, and you can. You can rent them out for massive amounts of money. The houses I'm looking at rent for about $4,000 a night. A night. They collect $200,000 or $300,000 a year in rental income. But do you really want other people living in your house? And then it really isn't your house. Then it becomes an investment. And if it becomes an investment, I haven't looked at all the numbers yet, but I don't think it comes any near the investment return we're getting. I'll look at it closer and get back with you on that. I'm just starting to research it a little bit. But the bottom line is do you really want to go somewhere where it isn't your home now? And it's just like if you're renting from yourself and they're renting from you, it's just another rental. Why not have one we just rent? You know, you pay the guy the $4,000 a night, you go live there, and then you leave. And again, everything's taken care of for you. You don't mess with it. You don't worry about it. You don't care about what happens to tax. You don't care if it's a hurricane. You got to board up the windows. And now that's a problem. So let's move on and talk about the next thing I thought was important. I also think it's important to talk to other people and to get perspectives. And like I said, I was sitting there with about five guys that have a network between $10 million for the lowest one in the room, maybe $100 million for the highest one in the room. And we're all sitting there one day. We're eating breakfast and we're talking about why is it when you go on vacation, even though you think you're rich in the U.S., you take a moment to relax and find out where all the really, really rich people are, all of a sudden you don't think you're so rich. And so a yacht goes cruising by, and we go, wow, that's neat. Let's look that yacht up. And so we looked it up. Don't know how much it cost. It could have been $100 million for the yacht. I don't know what it cost. $50 million for the yacht. I have no idea. But this was like a 120-foot yacht. And so I know it's not going to be something like $50,000 or even $500,000, even a million. It's got to be mega millions. And so we looked it up, and we found out it cost $4,000 for 4 hours. You can rent it in four-hour intervals for $4,000, or you can rent it for so much a day, like $8,000 a day. And you start looking at that thing, you say, man, who's got that kind of money? And you see, like, if you watch the Kardashians, you see they go on these kinds of vacations where they spend $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 to rent a house for a week. And, you know, if it's $4,000 a month, they stay 10 days, it's $40,000. You see that kind of money out there, and you go, wow, that's amazing. You start thinking, could I afford to live that way? And, you know, as we sat it there and we talked about it, we go like, well, one guy's, well, I'm not really there. And I'm saying, well, I'm probably there. And another guy goes, oh, yeah, I know a friend who has this and this and this and this. And they're like, it's nothing to them. There is other levels of wealth that are beyond you. So now you start to ask yourself a question. Remember these factoids to live by. You can have anything you want in life. You can't have everything you want. So you start asking yourself, where is it important to put my money? And those are the kinds of decisions you have to make. And when you're there, relax. You got all the time in the world to think about that and to clear your head and come up with some new ideas. We'll be right back with the Del Walmsley Radio Show.
Welcome back. Now here's some more unconventional wisdom to set you free from the man on a mission to retire America, one person at a time, Del Walmsley.
Welcome back to Del Walmsley Radio Show. Today we're talking about vacations and the benefit of it. Now I want to spend this segment and talk about some of the people that I met while I was on vacation, because I think it tells you something about life. One of the first individuals I met that was very interesting to me was a military guy there, and his wife said, yeah, he's been trying to talk me into moving to Texas from California. And, well, you need to go, young lady. You don't realize what you're missing. The quality of lifestyle, et cetera, et cetera. And so we started talking to this guy for a minute, and it's real hard. The guy says, I've been into real estate. And being into real estate to him meant that he bought a couple rent houses somewhere. But he didn't really realize that he was sitting there with five guys that were multimillionaires and their wives. But it just so happened we had five military people there. Within the 10 people that were there together, five of them were ex-military. So they started talking one at a time. He talked to them. And every time he was like, surprised. Okay, so you're an ex-military guy and you're now a multimillionaire? You know, how do you do that? And then that guy gets done speaking to him and he meets another guy. He goes, you're ex-military too? Yeah. And you're what? A multimillionaire? Yeah. And they all, each one of them told their story of how they became millionaires. And you could just see the guy over about a day and a half, 2 days of knowing the guy, his eyes open up and his heart open up. And he starts talking to us honestly and telling us what his real dreams are and what his real challenges are mentally. And it was just so nice to see you can help people still in this world. So we hooked him up with a bunch of people to contact. And Brian Sifford kind of befriended him and everything. And it was just one of those things that you could just see. It was so exciting to see somebody and his wife, which was funny because at first he said, I want to move to Texas, but my wife doesn't want to go. And by the time it was over, wife said, we got to get him to go down there. We got to get him to move. So she completely changed her mind. That's the power of going on vacation, guys. I mean, you sit at a pool next to multimillionaires and all of a sudden you no longer just want to be a Navy guy. You want to change. You want to be more. You want to get bigger. You look at another guy we met, which is a young guy, and he's a salesman. I mean, he's a hustler. And I've met guys like this before. They're just super hustlers. They could sell anything. He had a rattle and a shtick you wouldn't believe. He said, I could sell meanness to the devil or something. I don't know what it was. That, and I could sell water to a jet boat. Just crazy things I never heard before. But he had a spiel. He had a stick. And he just rattled on and 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 on. But his wife's the one that came and talked to us. She actually initiated the conversation with us. She was listening to us talk about something. I think it was politics or something. And so we started the conversation. You could just see that the guy wanted to be where we're at. And he said, let me come work for you. He literally just screamed at me, let me come work for you. I said, there's no jobs in my company for people that are not already millionaires. Everybody here has already done what we do, tested the program, made it work. Now they can help other people learn to do it. I said, you just can't come work for me. There's no job. They're going to give you a receptionist job or something. You know? Oh, no, man, I can sell. I go, there's nothing to sell. This sells itself. Being a multimillionaire, retiring in 2 years to 5 years, sells itself. We don't need high-pressure salesmen like you. We have laid-back guys like us that are just rich, and you talk to us for 5 minutes, you're going to want us. You're going to want to do what we do. And so it was interesting. So we got him all riled up now. Now he's looking into it and wants to do it. I mean, and it's not like by the time we left, these guys weren't saying, let me look into it. They're saying, when they first met us, it was like, okay, let me look into it. But the second day, they'd come down and go, I looked you up on the internet. Unbelievable. I want to be a part of it. You know, I'm like, okay, just enjoy yourself and we'll get you in there. Another interesting one is I ran into a guy that was like 70 years old. And the way I ran into him, he's like tan as could be, the darkest tan I've ever seen in my life. So I went up to the guy and I said, how many days of being here did it take you to get that tan? I mean, I was red, but he was dark red. And he goes, well, ha, 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 that's a funny thing. It hasn't been that many days and I'm not even trying to tan. I said, well, what do you mean? He says, well, I retired about 6 months ago and we've gone every week to a different resort. And I'm out in the sun every day at these resorts. Whenever I'm out there, right, by the pool, whatever. And it's occurred because I'm out there every single day for weeks and weeks and weeks on lot. And that's how I got so dark. He said, oh, well, here's my brother. He said, my brother is so jealous that I retired. And he's, I think he was 55 or 60, something like that. His brother was older. He's so jealous that I retired, man, blah, blah, blah. So I'm speaking to the brother now, the one that didn't retire. And he's rationalizing. Oh, yeah, but I don't work that hard, and I get to work from home because of COVID, and I've got a really sweet job, and my job's so good they never get rid of me because I'm the only guy that can do my job. And he had all the rationale to why he should be happy working his butt off, except that his brother's traveling around the world living life. And he had his brain that he had to work until he's 65, because his brother worked until he's 65. He's 55 or so. He thought he had to work to 65 to be able to have enough money to do what his brother does, which, again, is crazy. I'm just trying to get across to you that people don't realize that we're sitting there with guys in our group that were 40 years old, 45 years old, that were already worth $10 million and already retired. And these guys are 55 and one was 65 and just retired. And he was so proud of himself to retire by 65 years of age. And by the way, I'm not putting that down. Don't get me wrong. You know, a lot of people would be happy to retire by 65. But it was just the excitement of seeing it. So everywhere we went, we ran into people. And you had the conversations. And the conversations were, and like I said, we were in a very expensive hotel, so most of the people were older, and most of them had retired. Yet, when you talk to anybody else, everywhere else, they're still working. And so this vacation stuff is so important for people who work. But what I want to get across to you right this moment in this segment is that, hey, what if you are able to retire in 2 to 5 years? What is the level of stress to live where you don't have a job and you have money? And that's a caveat you got to realize. It's no fun to be retired if you don't have any money. You got to have both. So what is the stress level? You know, I was afraid to go out of the country because I'm kind of a type B pessimist. And I was afraid it's going to be all kinds of problems with COVID. I found very little problems with COVID. The only two things I found that were a little awkward were you had to get a COVID test to get back into the country, the U.S. To go out of the country, all you have to do is prove you had a shot. That was one thing. Second thing was, there's a international lie going on. And the lie is that masks work and that masks are important. And I'm not saying masks don't work, but I'm saying masks don't work the way the international lie works. Here's what I mean. You have to wear a mask in the airport and on a plane. That's period. The whole way. Had to have a mask on. Okay? So I'm saying, look, I understand that. I'll tolerate this. It's not a problem. Being that it's a finite amount of time. Everybody's doing it. It's not disproportionate. But when you go to places like there, to get into the restaurants, you had to have a mask or they wouldn't let you in. So they were sending people away from the front door. We can't let you in without a mask. And there were vendors out there selling masks for like $5 a piece because you're trapped. I had a mask, so it didn't bother me. But some of the people in our party didn't have a mask because they were kind of Republicans and they're libertarians and like, I'm not wearing a mask, blah, 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 blah. I don't care about any of this stuff. I have no political aspirations to either side, especially not over a darn mask. So you buy the mask and then you'd walk through the door and you'd get in. Nobody in the restaurant has a mask on except the employees. And so the second you walk in, you put it on, get by the door guy, then you take it off and go down and sit and eat. Same thing was true with the gym. When I went to the health club, they wouldn't let you in the health club unless you had a mask. The restaurants wouldn't let you in without a mask. To go in and get a massage, you had to have a mask to get through one door. Once you got through one door, you take the mask off. That is the lie out there going on. But it's an international lie. They're doing it there. They do it here. It's just It's kind of crazy. But the reality is, the travel was easy. The enjoyment, the entertainment, the people we met was incredible. And you just can't replace what it does for you to take a vacation. Take a short break. Be right back with the Del Walmsley Radio Show.
Welcome back. Now here's some more unconventional wisdom to set you free from the man on a mission to retire America, one person at a time, Del Walmsley.
Welcome back to Del Walmsley Radio Show. With me here today is Lee Reeves. Lee is one of our national presenters for our program, and he gets around the country teaching the classes for people. Lee's also a retired attorney and has come to Lifestyles and became an investor and had been successful enough to retire. Lee, let's talk about this. I don't know if you're listening in the early segment. It's about vacations and about clearing your head and so forth. I remember when I first spoke with you, and you were in New York, and you were talking about the stress levels in the style of life you were living with your job. Can you share with people what that was like and what the difference is, what you have now and the way you live today?
Yeah, happy to. Wow, when you said about our conversation when I was up in New York, yeah, total 180 degrees from where I am now. Everything was stress. Everything was work. I mean, that was just all-consuming. And that's totally changed around. And I was thinking as I was listening to your earlier segments that, you know, for the most part, my life today is a vacation. And every once in a while, so that doesn't get boring, I have to go and do some work. And it really is about the lifestyle. It's not about the money. It's about how you're spending your time. And, you know, I lived down in Houston for a while, as you know, and have lived up in Franklin, Tennessee for the last couple years. I live in a neighborhood where I can go to any of three different pools. I can go hang out with the neighbors. There's just a hundred other things to do than work, and I almost have to take a break from it every once in a while and go buy another apartment complex.
That's interesting to say you flipped it up on its head, and now you, like these people, take three vacations a year, you work, and you take three work days a month or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. I have a weekly call with my staff. I have some apartment communities, and obviously we stay on top of things. But while everything is 95% full and operating well, there's very little to do. And I like it that way. I've determined. You had mentioned earlier that I'm a retired attorney. I prefer a recovering attorney. It's a multi-step process.
Hey, so, you know, an interesting point, though, you make. One of the things that, and I forgot about this until you just brought it up, but one of the things I thought was the most interesting to me was when I worked in corporate America, I was in sales. So sales and legal work, I don't know if you're any close the same, but something has to be accomplished. So there's constant stress. And I remember no matter what I sold in health club memberships, it was never enough. We could always have a higher quota. And so we'd break the quotas. They'd give us a quota. We'd break the quotas. We'd be running. The business was running perfectly well. And that was an indication it was time to do more. Where when I bought my own rent houses, I go, okay. And I started out with eight of them. All eight houses are rented. There's nothing to do. The checks come in. And I go, but what? That's the nicest part is that it's done. Is there not a point in anything when it's done? And so I got back from vacation, and I bet I had eight checks sitting in my mailbox from all these different companies, right? And they're all sitting here, and I'm like, okay, I got to go to the bank now and deposit these checks. Oh, gosh, terrible. But then I got an email. Yeah. I'm closing on three more deals this week. I go, oh, my God, I've had to work or do nothing, go on vacation. Now I've got to go and go to three closings. And I'm just thinking, gosh, that's terrible.
Tough, man.
I got to go to get an attorney's office and sign the paperwork. I'm actually to sign the paperwork on all three deals at the same time. And it's going to be over with. Give them a check and close and then make more money. And it just blows my mind how different it really is. So now,
it really is.
What about this cost of living thing? That's another one that gets me. I'm down in Mexico and I'm looking at mansions overlooking the sea in all directions, about 180 to 280 degree view of the ocean up on a cliff. And, you know, you're talking about $3 million instead of $30 million. I looked at a house in Florida. It was $23 million bucks. I'm looking at the same kind of house in Mexico, and it's $5 million bucks. And you're thinking, man, the cost of living is completely different here. What about coming out of New York and getting into where you're living now, or even Houston's probably cheaper than that even?
Oh, Houston was a massive difference. I had to do a, an exchange rate to figure out what cost that thing cost down there. It was crazy. Loved it, though. Loved it. And it allowed me to get into real estate the way that I did.
I'm going to segue now because we got to get some stuff in here about what you've got going on. You're in charge of the national stuff. So tell everybody what's going on around the country they can get involved in if they're not already involved, or if they are involved, more stuff they can do.
Absolutely. If you guys want to experience a little bit of what Dell and I are talking about, go to lifestylesunlimited.com and sign up for one of our free workshops. We've got one coming up this upcoming weekend. We've also got case studies coming up in Houston on Thursday, July 8th, and in North Texas, July 15th. And if you know you want to sign up for the 2-day Financial Freedom Seminar, go to givemetotalfreedom.com. And the promo code is Dell. There is an in-person and online on Saturday and Sunday, July 10th and 11th. I'm teaching the 4-part evening series starting Tuesday, July 13th. That's next week. And there is an end-of-the-month 2-day Financial Freedom Seminar in person in Indianapolis, July 31st and August 1st.
You've got about another 30 seconds here. Is there anything else you'd like to bring up? Didn't you have something in Utah coming up? Brian said he was going to teach in Utah sometime.
We do. So we do have something in Utah. I'm not sure on the date on that, but I know we have an educational road trip in Salt Lake City on Saturday, July 17th. And we also have an educational road trip in Chattanooga, Tennessee, this coming weekend on the 10th. I'll be there, and I know a bunch of other folks will too. And it's really exciting to be out in the country doing live events again.
Yeah, that is great, especially now that we're all over the country. It blows my mind how many different locations that we're in now. And so I hope people can get us. Again, one more time, how can they get a hold of us?
Go to lifestylesunlimited.com and register for a free workshop, or go to givemetotalfreedom.com, promo code Dell, to sign up for our 2-day workshop.
Lastly, but not leastly, the expo is coming up, the National Expo and bus trip, and that's going to be September 3rd and 4th, so you don't want to miss that either. Lee, thanks for coming on. The rest of you out there, remember this, it's not the money, it's the lifestyle. Have a wonderful day.
The information and opinions you hear on the Del Walmsley Radio Show are those of the host, Del Walmsley, his guests, and his callers, and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of this station, its affiliates, its management, or advertisers. The Del Walmsley Show is for entertainment purposes only. Please consult a professional regarding your personal investment needs. Nothing presented on the Del Walmsley Show constitutes an endorsement, recommendation, offer, or solicitation to buy or sell any product or security.